Today we'll be talking about paradise and hell. Paradise and hell. So, I'm not sure if you knew this, but before people could go up to heaven, they could not go up to heaven back then. What they had to do during those days is they had to go where hell was. So paradise had to be in hell a long, long time ago. Why is that, Pastor? The key reason why is because of sin. That's the reason why. So look at Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. What you must understand is that they did not have a complete life, permanent life. It was only temporary, incomplete. I'll explain why. Look at Galatians chapter 3. We will look at verse 21. Verse 21. Notice what the Bible says about the Old Testament. Is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. So notice right here, if the law could give life, then we should have remained in the Old Testament under the law. But under the Old Testament law, it could not give that complete life, permanent life. So let's keep reading. The verse says right here, verse 22, but the scripture hath concluded all under what? Sin. Because no matter how hard the Old Testament saints lived by the law, can any man be perfect without sin as they follow the law? No, everyone is still a sinner. So because of that, that's why it's incomplete. It was temporary. It was not permanent, complete life. All under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. So before then, what they had to do, before faith came, they were under the law. Notice right here, but before faith came, so showing right here that people in the Old Testament, see, they were not saved by faith alone. That could not have been available. So this verse is proof of dispensationalism and even different salvations. Amen. This is a complete verse on that. We were kept under the law, see that? Shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. So they cannot be saved by faith alone without works. Why? Because the obvious answer is because Jesus Christ did not die on the cross yet. Yes, sir. So because Jesus Christ did not die on the cross yet, where he can do all the work for them, they had to do the work themselves. But even though their salvation was based on that, it was not complete, permanent, as you read at verse 21. So where do all sins go to if it's not allowed in heaven? That's right. If it's not allowed up in heaven, there's only one place that it could go. It could go to hell. It has to go to hell. However, if you are a saved person and you try to live the best that you could, God can't just damn them to hell like the lost. That would be unfair. Mm-hmm. So he had a section in hell where one part, it was the damned, lost people, and then across it was Abraham's bosom. So there was a damnation zone and a comfort zone. Look at the book of Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. We're going to look at verse 22. Luke chapter 16. And we're going to look at verse 22. Notice what Jesus talked about during the Old Testament. During the Old Testament, when people died, where they had to go was everyone had to go to hell, but lost people were the ones in damnation, whereas the saints, they were in a place of comfort. Look at Luke chapter 16, verse 22. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. See that? So this saved person went to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. Now look at this. And in where? Hell, he lift up his eyes being in torments. But notice right here. And seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. So notice right here that this lost rich man is able to see this saved person, Lazarus, who died. They're able to see. Why? What's going on here? Notice, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. Torment, lost. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receiveth thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, see that, and thou art tormented. So there's a distinguishment where these two people are in their places. But notice they're in the same location, because, verse 26, and beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from you hence to you cannot. So notice right here that there's a gulf between them. So there's a gulf that's between them. So showing right here that they are in the same location, because they're able to talk to each other, they're able to see each other, and they're right across from each other. So this shows right here that Abraham's bosom back then, they were down here, not up in heaven, which makes sense, because all sin has to be locked up in a location where hell is. It's not allowed in heaven. Okay, let's also look at Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. When Jesus died on the cross, he showed right here, these two verses show that where paradise was for the saints was definitely in hell. It had to be in hell. Because look at Matthew chapter 12, and we're going to look at verse 40. Jesus Christ said that when he died, he had to go into the heart of the earth. He did not go up here. He had to go down here. That's what the Bible says at verse 40. For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man, Jesus, be 3 days and three nights in heaven? No, in the heart of the earth. See that? Below the earth, where hell is. So he had to go down there. But when he went down there after he died, he called that paradise. Look at Luke 23. Luke chapter 23. He called that paradise. Really? Why would he call hell paradise? That doesn't make sense. Unless you compare that with Luke 16 here, that there is a blissful place, a paradise place for the saved people that's in hell. Then it would match. Look at Luke chapter 23. We're going to look at verse 43. This proves it right here. Verse 43. And Jesus said unto him, so Jesus said to the thief on the cross who got saved, verily, verily, I say unto thee, today, see, that day when he died, today shalt thou be with me in where? Paradise. See that? So the day that he died, the verse says he went to hell, right? But no, he says he went to paradise. So unless there's a contradiction here, or it makes sense that instead of contradictions, it confirms scripture with scripture. Amen. And then it shows that paradise, Abraham's bosom, where the saints are, is down here, where hell is. All right, let's also look at Romans chapter 5. Now, this is something very, very important, okay, to understand about a paradise and hell. There are two important factors. If you don't keep these two factors in mind, then you will not understand why God had to have a paradise below hell. It's first concerning about sin. All right, look at Romans chapter 5 verse 12. Wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Everyone has to die, see? Why? Because of sin. So because of sin, everyone has to die. So if sin brings forth death, and if this thing is not solved, that means they can't go to heaven. But if this thing is solved, then they can go to heaven. Yes, sir. That's point number one to remember. Amen. Point number two to remember, which will be helpful, is also the key word in every dispensation. Look at 1 Chronicles 16. 1 Chronicles 16. The Jew. That is absolutely important. The Jew. Israel. Why? Because God made an eternal covenant with the nation of Israel. Now, Israel, is it a physical nation or a spiritual nation?
Physical.
It's physical. That's obvious. Christians, are we a physical nation or spiritual nation?
Spiritual.
We're spiritual. So this is the important thing. Because Israel is a physical nation, how does God deal with them then? Physically. But if Christians are a spiritual nation, how does God deal with us? Spiritually.
Amen.
So here's something very important. Because they're physical, God has to operate, deal with Israel physically. So because Israel is a physical nation, and that's an eternal covenant by God, they have to be based on physical dealings. That's why they go by physical works of the law, and their salvation is physical. See, that's why they could not go by spiritual faith alone at the New Testament that time. See that? This is spiritual, right? But over here, I mean, faith is spiritual. That's a no-brainer right here. But law, that ain't spiritual. That's physical. Keeping the Sabbath day, eating the right kind of food, working in this, doing this good thing, that thing. You're all working in your body to do that, right? See, so that's physical. So that explains why, remember, these deeds that they've done, they're works of the law. Is it complete permanent life or is it incomplete temporary? It's incomplete temporary. So based on the physical works, it's not enough to get them here. So where do they go? That's why they go here. So these two things are absolutely important. So here's the thing. If this thing is answered and solved away, then they can go to heaven. If this thing is answered and solved away, they can go to heaven. But if you have these two things, you have to be based down here. All right, so let's look at some of these verses. Look at 1 Chronicles 16, verse 15. Be mindful always of his covenant. See that? It's a covenant. God can't break it. The word which he commanded to 1,000 generations, even of the covenant which he made with Abraham and of his oath unto Isaac, and hath confirmed the same to Jacob for a law, and to Israel for a what? Everlasting covenant. Notice the same to Jacob for a law. See that? It's based on physical dealings, physical law, physical nation. And that's eternal. God can't break it.
Amen.
Remember that. God can't break it. So this is eternal. God can't take back his covenant with Israel.
Amen.
So this thing, this is important to know, that's why this thing cannot be replaced by Christians. It cannot be replaced. It has to continue. And that's going to show something significant in the tribulation, something very interesting.
Amen.
But anyway, let's return, all right? Let's go to Daniel 9, Daniel 9. Notice that Israel's salvation is very, very different from Christian salvation. This salvation of theirs is not complete. It has to continue even after the tribulation because it's based on their physical nation. Not the spiritual faith, everything done by the work of Christ. It's very different because look at right here, Daniel 9, and we're going to look at verse 24. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression. 70 weeks are determined to finish their sin and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy. Now, does it take 70 weeks for us to finish up all of our sins and the transgression? No. It's immediately done on that very day when you knelt on your knees and received Christ for salvation.
Yes, sir.
But this one has to go by 70 weeks. Why? Because it's based, notice right here, on their nation. Their nation. Their nation. If you look at the 70th week, that continues in the tribulation. So let's also look at Colossians 1. Colossians 1. So what's important is that Israel, it's an eternal covenant, it's physical. There's no doubt. When it talks about the nation, the nation, the nation. So Israel is a nation, obviously. So physical, nation. When you see this, it's physical. So this thing has to continue. That's why it's not replaced by the Christians because it's going to be continued in the tribulation. Because why? Because of Daniel's 70th week. That's why. The 70th week continues on the tribulation. So what's going on right here is that when God dealt with Israel, right here, at this time period, it has to continue later over here. And this is not during Israel's time period. This is what? Faith, right? Over here was law with Israel, right? So right here, it's forever, it's eternal. But it had to be postponed and moved over here to continue. And the Christians continue it right here. Why? Because let's look at right here. Like Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. Let's solve this. So how do you go to heaven? If you get either or solved, all right, one or two. One is solved right here. Look at Colossians 1:13. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath what? Translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. So notice what saves you from all your sin problem. It's translation. Translation. So that's why, look at Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11. Why? Because translation is a transformation from something sinful to something that's completely sinless. Amen. That's why, what makes sense, Enoch and other Old Testament saints, why were they able to go to heaven? Not down here. Because right here, concerning sin and death, it's based on what? He had his rapture right here. Yes, sir. Because of that rapture, he doesn't face the... See that? This thing, this penalty is out. Death. Death of all sins. He avoided that.
Amen.
He avoided that, showing right here, this thing has been solved right here. Why? Because God translated him. That's why Enoch and a few other Old Testament saints were able to go up. Look at Hebrews 11, verse 5. What did the Bible say? By faith, Enoch was what? Translated that he should not see death. See that? He avoided that. That's why he can go up. But was everybody translated like Enoch during the Old Testament?
No.
So because of this, where did they go? Right there, right here. So silly Stephen Anderson, who uses Enoch, Elijah, and other people to prove there is no such thing as a paradise below the earth, they base their whole doctrine about going to heaven in the Old Testament just on two simple verses, Enoch and Elijah. That's it. But if they didn't look at all the tons of verses that showed why they went up and why others can't go up. You know why Enoch and others were able to go up? Because of they had the translation. Other people didn't. Notice in Hebrews 11:5, because God had what? Translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. See, God did the translation for him. So that's why he went up. What a blessing he got.
Amen.
Yeah, amen to that.
Bless that.
Now let's also look at Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4. Ephesians chapter 4.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Well then, Pastor, I guess we can't get number one right here about translation solved. So how are we going to go up? But the Lord did something.
Yes, sir.
The second thing right here is to go to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. Because look at right here. The Bible says, wherefore he saith, when he ascendeth up on high, that's Jesus. When he went up to heaven, what did he do? Notice right here, he led captivity captive. So there was a bunch of captivities that he freed and gave gifts unto men. What is this captivity from? Look at verse 9. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also what? Descended first. See that? He first went down, not up, into the lower parts of the earth. Hell. See that? He first went down here, Jesus Christ. And what did that verse say? He led what? Captivity, captives. He freed the captives. Well, obviously, that's not the lost people. They're damned. Who are the captives? See that? It's the saved people. They were able to be freed and to go to heaven. Why? Because even though they did not, not every single Old Testament saint had the translation, they had what? They had this one. They had this one that cleared their sin problem. Because why? It's based on Colossians. Go back to Colossians. Colossians 1:13. Look at this verse. We read it before. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. Translation, right? But look at this translation. 14. In whom we have what? Redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. See that? They got this translation, the blood of Jesus Christ. So because of that, that's why they were able to go up to heaven. That's how the Lord solved it. Let's also look at 2 Corinthians 12. 2 Corinthians 12. So, what you're going to notice right here is that's why paradise, if Jesus Christ carried all the people in Abraham's bosom up to heaven, the captives, that means he carried paradise up to heaven too. Really? Yeah, because look at 2 Corinthians 12. We're going to look at verse 2. Where is paradise now in the New Testament? Verse 2. I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago. Whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell, God knoweth. Such a one caught up to where? The third heaven. So he's up there. But what's in the third heaven? Verse 4. How that he was caught up into where? Paradise. See that? Paradise is now up here. So we see from scripture with scripture, paradise used to be down here, but then Jesus Christ carried it up there. So, if we were to die today, even though we don't get that translation like Enoch had, what kind of translation we got? What were we based out of? We were based on this one, faith. Faith in the spiritual work of Jesus Christ. Not only that, we're no longer the physical nation of Israel, right? Mm-hmm. Christians is what? Spiritual, right?
Yep.
So because we got this thing solved right here, and the translation solved right here, that's why we can go up to here. But remember, if you don't have this thing solved, either or, then what's going to happen? Then what happens is you have to go to right here, Galatians chapter 3. Galatians 3 said we were under the law, and it was before faith came. But now that we're under faith, what did Galatians 3 said? It says we are no longer under the law, which is our schoolmaster.
Yes, sir.
So that's why we're based out of this one now. Let's also look at Revelation 6. Revelation chapter 6. Now in the Bible, there's going to be two different altars mentioned. Two different altars mentioned right here. In the book of Revelation, there is an altar. And this altar, it's debated. What is this altar? This altar is actually the altar in Jerusalem, Revelation 6. But some people think that the altar at Revelation 6 is not the altar on the earth, but rather the altar up in heaven. See where this place is. We do know this. In the book of Revelation, there are two different altars. It's not the one and same altar up in heaven. They're two different. Because why? Well, first, let's look at Revelation 6, and I'll explain. Revelation 6, verse 9. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Notice right here, there are souls under the altar. Now, here's something very interesting. Because there are souls around, no, it says under. It says souls that are under the altar. Now, here's something that you gotta think about. If it's referring to an altar on earth and there are souls underneath that, what does that mean? That means they're again in this paradise below the earth, where saved souls are at. That's what it's going to show right here. But there are people who find that very confusing, so they think that maybe it's referring to this altar up in heaven. But let's explain why it's going to be actually this one. It's actually going to be an altar on the earth. Because why? Let's look at Revelation 11. First of all, the first case to establish is there is absolutely no doubt there are two different altars at Revelation, not just one up in heaven. It's because of Revelation 11, that's why. You can't deny that. Revelation 11 talks about an altar that's in Jerusalem. So there's an altar in Jerusalem right here because of Revelation 11. Look at verse 1. And there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood saying, Rise and measure the temple of God and the altar, and them that worship therein. Okay, but what's this temple? What's this altar? It's on earth. Look at verse 2. But the court which is without the temple leave out, and measure it not. For it is given unto who? The Gentiles. And note, and the what? Holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. So notice right here, it's talking about an altar in Jerusalem. There's no doubt in Revelation 11. There is an altar. If you look at Revelation 8, there's also a different altar. If you look at Revelation 8, there are many other chapters to show this. 8, 3 through 5, chapter 9, verse 13, 14, verse 18, 16, 7. There's one at the third heaven too. So there's no doubt there are two different altars. Now the question is this. How do we know that the altar in Revelation 6 is referring to the altar at Revelation 11 at Jerusalem? It could be this one, right? So how do we know which one's which? We go through process of elimination. Through process of elimination, we're going to find out there are many strong reasons why the altar of Revelation 6 is undoubtedly the altar at Jerusalem. The first reason is this. If you look at Revelation 6, you'll notice right here at verse 9, under the altar, the souls of them that were slain for the word of God. Verse 10, they cried out for their blood, vengeance, their blood. Why? Because there's a lot of killing, martyrdom surrounding this altar. If you look at Revelation chapter 11, 1 and 2, the altar at Jerusalem, what happens in Jerusalem, the holy city? There's a bunch of killing, martyrdom. Because look at verse 7, 8, and 9. See that? 7, 8, and 9. These saints are killed at Jerusalem, where the altar is. So there's a lot of bloody violence surrounding this altar, martyrdom. So there's no doubt it would make sense that Revelation 6 altar would match with the Revelation 11 altar because of so many bloody violence surrounding it. But not only that, if you also look at Revelation 6, you'll notice that the altar that the saints are crying about in Revelation chapter 6, verse 10, their vengeance is not complete. They're begging for vengeance around this altar. How long, O Lord, verse 10, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou now judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? In this altar, they request for vengeance. So I'm going to write the several points right here. Anyways, let's just say avenge.
I always do that too.
My goodness, how can I forget that word? Basic English. But anyway, let's just do this. Avenge. And also right here is bloody violence, martyrdom. So right here, they're requesting vengeance. But in Revelation 8 altar, that altar up in heaven, it's not the souls that's requesting for vengeance. It's actually fulfilling the vengeance. Look at Revelation 16. We're going to look at verse 6. For they have shed the blood of saints and prophets, and thou hast given them blood to drink, for they are worthy. See that? The vengeance for God's saints is completed from what? From that altar. Look at verse 7. And I heard another out of the altar say, Even so, Lord God Almighty, true and righteous are thy judgments. See that? That altar in heaven is fulfilling the vengeance for the saints. But this altar does not fulfill the vengeance of the saints. In fact, it's the opposite. It doesn't fulfill the vengeance of the saints. They're getting what? Killed, martyred right here. So that's why this Revelation 6 altar, it would more match with this altar in Jerusalem. It makes more sense rather than this altar up in heaven. But not only that, also look at chapter 8, verse 3. These souls are under the altar, right? That would not make sense with souls under the altar in heaven. All right, that would not make sense. Look at chapter 8, verse 3. The Bible says, "And another angel came out and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar," which was before what? Before the throne. Okay, so this is something important. Here's the throne in heaven. This altar is before the throne. Now, you know what's before the throne? It's this sea of glass. Look at the book of Revelation, chapter 5. Chapter 5.
Good teaching.
Chapter 5. We're going to look at Revelation chapter 4, 4 verse 6. 4 verse 6. Notice that before the throne is the bottom of heaven, the sea of glass. Look at Revelation chapter 4. We're going to look at verse 6. "And before the throne, there was a" what? "Sea of glass, like unto crystal." Look at this. Before the throne, was a sea of glass bottom. Now, remember, the souls are where? Under the altar. Would it make sense that here's the bottom floor of heaven? If the souls are underneath this altar of heaven, then that means they're not in heaven. That wouldn't make sense, right? That would not make sense. But wouldn't it make more sense with this altar that the souls are under it? Yes, because guess where do the dead go? Where do the dead go after they die? They go on to the underworld. Let's also look at chapter 5. Revelation chapter 5, we're going to look at verse 3. Not only that, look at every time what the author meant by under. The author, okay? The author of Revelation, John. When John talks about under, you know what he means? It's very interesting what he meant by under. All of the times, it literally meant below the earth's floor. That's one. Look at chapter 5, verse 3. "And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither" what? "Under the earth." That's one time, the first time it's mentioned. Look at verse 13. "And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth," and what? "Under the earth." That's the second time it's mentioned. Now let's look at chapter 11, verse 2. Here's the third time it's mentioned. And it's below your feet. It's below the feet. "But the court which is without the temple leave out, and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread" what? "Under foot." See, it's underneath your feet. Not only that, look at chapter 12, verse 1. Chapter 12, verse 1. "And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, and the moon" what? "Under her feet." So look at this, see? If we're saying under the earth, and this is the earth, under where? Under feet, where would it most likely fit in? Right here, see, below the earth, underneath the feet. That would make more sense. So when you look at scripture with scripture with scripture, all these verses pointing together, does it seem to show more strongly that the Revelation 6 altar is this altar up in heaven or the altar at Jerusalem? What do you think? It's the altar at Jerusalem. So there is absolutely no doubt about that when looking at all these verses. So if there are souls underneath the altar in Jerusalem, then that means then it's going back to what? It's going back to right here, Abraham's bosom, paradise below the earth. So then the question is this, but isn't paradise already carried up to heaven? See that? So because after Jesus died on the cross, he carried paradise. paradise up to heaven, so it shouldn't be there anymore, right? What's going to be very surprising and eye-opening is this. What is paradise based upon? That's important. If you remember these two points, it's going to explain why it makes sense paradise is going to come back here again. Let me explain. Okay, let's go one at a time. First of all, let me explain this. The word paradise, it does not have to mean one specific place. That's what you understand. Some people think that because paradise is a name of a specific place, that place is already up here, so there, it wouldn't make sense that there are two. See that? But here's the thing. Paradise is not the name of a specific place. If you look up the word paradise, do you know what it means? It's interesting. Merriam-Webster Dictionary, the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, it defines paradise as an intermediate place or state where the souls of the righteous await resurrection and the final judgment.
Wow.
Look at that. So notice right here that even Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines paradise as an intermediate place of soul awaiting resurrection. Remember, paradise, you escape it based on what? Translation. Resurrection. That's why what you're going to find out, we're going to build up all these points together, all right? We're going to build up all these points together. This is going to be very interesting.
This is fun.
It is fun. The tribulation saints, when they die, their souls are under the altar, and that's why there is a what eventually? There is eventually a post-tribulation rapture. Mm-hmm. And in this post-tribulation rapture, they get their resurrection, right? So because they get their resurrection, their translation, they're stuck here in the meantime. Intermediate place awaiting what? For that resurrection, where they go up. Look at Revelation chapter 20. Once you have Revelation 20, go to Matthew 24. Matthew 24. Revelation 20 and Matthew 24. That's why it makes sense there is a post-tribulation rapture. Some people wonder and say, why does there have to be a post-tribulation rapture? I mean, we believe in a pre-tribulation rapture, amen? That's Christians. Christians believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. But why do we believe another rapture? That's the question. Why do we believe in another rapture, a post-tribulation? Because everything makes sense. Everything connects the dots. You'll either do this. You'll either be dumb like Steven Anderson and think dispensationalism is so convoluted that it doesn't make sense. Or if you study everything, it connects everything together and makes absolute sense. Amen. We're going to look at verse 4, Revelation chapter 20. We're going to look at verse 4. The Bible says right here, "And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw," look at this, "the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus." So these are tribulation saints, their souls. Notice the souls are not revealed until when? Until after that resurrection, that rapture. "And for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived," see that? There's a resurrection, "and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished." This is the first resurrection. See that? They had a resurrection. So the tribulation saints, they had a resurrection. Why did they have a resurrection? So that this thing can be solved, translation. And by doing that, they can leave this place and go up here. See that? Let's look at Matthew 24, verse 29. Matthew 24, 29. "Immediately after the tribulation," okay, so what happens after the tribulation? There's a rapture. Verse 31, "And he shall send his angels with the great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other." See that? They're gathering together God's elect and taking them up to heaven. You see that? So there's a post-tribulation rapture. That's why it makes sense the tribulation saints have this rapture. Why? So that they can get out of here. Why? Because this thing can be solved. Remember, Abraham's bosom paradise, it's based, it has to be there, these two unshakable factors. Unless these two factors are solved out, then they can leave this place. But if you have these two factors in play, this has to be here. Look at Revelation 7. Revelation 7. Why does there have to be a paradise below the earth during the tribulation? Because God returns to Israel. That's why. God returns to Israel. Israel, remember, are they based on spiritual dealings like Christians?
No.
Nope. They are physical dealings, right?
Mm-hmm.
God made an eternal covenant, right? So he can't replace it with Christians. He can't replace it with this. He has to go back to this physical nation of Israel, continue down the physical aspects, the physical works, physical nation of Israel, and physical nationality of their salvation. Look at this. Revelation chapter 7, verse 4. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of who? All the tribes of the children of Israel. See that? During the tribulation, the Jews return. The Jews return. Israel.
Not Jehovah's Witness.
Not Jehovah's Witness. Amen. That's why. Why? Because remember the 70th week of Daniel? See that? The scriptures are building up together. They're building up together. That's why Israel has to return. Look at chapter 12. Chapter 12. Notice that they do faith and works for salvation. It's not faith alone. Why? Because physical, again, physical. So they have to have not just faith, but physical works. Look at Revelation chapter 12, verse 17. The Bible says, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed. What did he do with the Jews? Which what? Keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. See that? Works and faith. Works and faith. They have to do that for their salvation. Let's also look at Romans 11. Romans 11. That's why it makes sense. Then the tribulation, you have to have faith and works for salvation. That makes sense. Why? Because it's going back to Jews again, physical dealings. That's why it makes sense. They have to go down to paradise right here. Why? Because of that second factor. God's dealing with the physical nation of Israel. Oh, that's why they have to have a post-tribulation rapture. Why? Because to solve this thing. You see how everything is connecting together.
Amen.
That book is fascinating. Let's look at Romans chapter 11, verse 25. For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery. So don't be ignorant, all right? Don't be dumb, all right? Unless you're a post-tribber, unless you're like Steven Anderson, then you're going to be dumb and ignorant. Because why? Look at this. Lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, like Steven Anderson. He thought he was such a smart aleck that when he tried to debate against White, he looked like a fool and an idiot. He was wise in his own conceit. That blindness in part is happened to Israel. So notice, Paul is speaking to Christians, right? Romans. He says Israel is blinded. That's why right here, from here to here, it's not Israel. It was what? Us, spiritual nation, Christians. So blindness in part has happened to Israel, but see this? Until when? Until when? Until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so what? All Israel shall be saved. As it is written, see, this is future. There shall come out of Zion, that's Jesus, the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. He's going to take away their sins completely. Why? At the future, why does he do that? Daniel 70th week. Remember Daniel 9? 70 weeks are determined to complete your transgression, to take away the sins. See, he's returning to nation again, nation. Let's also look at verse 27, verse 27. For this is my what? Covenant. See that? He didn't forget it. It's eternal. when I shall take away their sins, because of Daniel 9. And what? Look at verse 29. You can't get rid of this. For the gifts and calling of God are what? Without repentance. He can't change his mind. It's not replaced.
Amen.
You can't replace it. It has to be eternal. It has to continue. That's why it makes sense. It goes here. That's why it makes sense. They do faith and works because they're physical. That's why it makes sense because of this second factor. They go here. That's why it makes sense. They have a post-tribulation rapture. Why? To solve this factor right here. You see what scripture with scripture with scripture connects everything together. See, this is such a blessing, studying the Bible, dispensationalism. But if you dismiss all that and loose all the connections, make it all metaphorical, and say, oh, that's just too complicated, so let's not connect it together so that you can see all this gold mine, then you'll just be dumb and ignorant like Steven Anderson and many people, and you're going to lose, and you're going to miss all this amazing things out of the Bible.
So
don't
fast.
Do that.
Yeah.
The Bible says, open thou mine eyes, and I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. Don't take away the wonder, post-tribber. Don't take away the wonder, replacement theology. Keep the wonder. Leave that book alone. Let it read what it says. Let it read what it says. And when you let it read what it says, then that's why it will all connect together and make sense.
Yes, sir.
Let's close it off with two passages. Let's look at Revelation 14. Revelation chapter 14. We're also going to turn to Revelation 7. Revelation 7. Revelation 14 and Revelation 7. This also explains this too. If you look at Revelation chapter 7, the verse is very interesting. The tribulation saints, they apply the blood on themselves. Christ does not apply the blood on them. When we got saved, when we spiritual Christians got saved by faith, who applied the blood on us? Jesus Christ. We didn't do it ourselves.
Amen.
Jesus Christ did it. But here it's different. They apply the blood on themselves. Why? That's why it makes sense they go down here. See that? Because they have to apply it on themselves based on what? Physical works. Look at right here, Revelation 7. Revelation 7, 14. And I said unto them, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which came out of great tribulation. So people in the tribulation, what do? And have what? Washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Did it say that and are washed or and have washed their robes? They do the washing. Christ doesn't. Look at every single verse about Christians, if you don't believe me. Every single verse about Christians connected to the blood. We're going to always, always be in the passive tense, are washed by Jesus Christ.
Yes,
every single time. Mm-hmm. Or Jesus Christ washes us. But every time,
Amen.
I challenge you this. If you don't believe me, I challenge you this. Every time you look at a tribulation saint connected to the blood of Jesus, there's a work combined in that. They wash it themselves.
Amen. They have to.
Because look at the second time it's mentioned, chapter 12, the second time it's mentioned, verse 11. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, look at this, martyrdom, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Look at that, works. You have to be faithful all the way to the end. You have to have a clean testimony. How many of you can brag about your testimony in our church lately?
Never.
Not really good, right? Not really good, yeah.
I got that blood.
So then, because of that bad testimony, we're not considered to be those saved people at chapter 12.
Yes,
see that? So that proves there has to be a difference with these saints and us.
Mm-hmm.
See, these saints, there's no doubt about it. It's based on works.
Amen.
It's based on faith and works. Faith and works.
That's the truth.
Why is it that they have to be faithful all the way to martyrdom, have a clean testimony? It makes sense because of one key factor. Go to Revelation 14. Revelation 14. Because of this. That's why.
Mark of the beast.
Where does this go? On your physical body, does it not?
Forehead.
See that? because it goes on your physical body, you have to, I don't care what you say, this is not going to help you, just this.
Yes, sir.
If this is going to go on your physical body, you have to physically resist it, physically act against it, physically work against it. That's why there's works involved. Yeah. See that? Look at Revelation 14, verse 10.
On the corner.
The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God if you receive the mark of the beast. If you go to hell, notice you go to hell. Why? Because of verse 11. The smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. See that? If you receive that mark, you go to hell. You go to hell. And that's described as, look at verse 12, faith and works, 12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that what? Keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. See that? Faith and works. It see, scripture with scripture makes sense. You see how this connects, this connects, this connects, this connects, this connects, this connects, this connects. This connects, everything else connects to each other.
Yep.
Look at that.
Perfect.
Revelation 20, right? I mentioned. Look at chapter 22, excuse me, not 20, chapter 22. Where do we see paradise mentioned? Well, chapter 2, verse 7, you don't have to turn there, but chapter 2, verse 7 mentions paradise again. It says, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. One day, you're going to understand that all this is going to be gone at the eternity. Mm-hmm. There is the paradise is where the tree of life is, it says, where the tree of life is. One day, God will wipe this all cleaned up. God will clean all this up, and this will be your paradise. When eternity hits, when all is over, for all eternity, God puts his paradise for saints of all ages. And that paradise is where the tree of life is, right? So that's Revelation 22, eternity. Go to Revelation 22, where the tree of life is mentioned. Revelation 22, we'll close it here. Verse 2. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life. See that? 3. And there shall be no more curse, praise the Lord. But the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, praise the Lord. And his servants shall serve him, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads, Amen. Replacing that mark of the beast. And there shall be no night there, and they need no candle, neither light of the sun. For the Lord God giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Eternity. That's where paradise will finally be at the end. And by that time, the Lord, when he wipes away everything clean, he refreshes everything with, this is the final paradise, eternity based, right here, forever and ever and ever. Now, that's your doctrine about God's paradise.
Nice.